friends, today we are going to discuss an important topic, and that is shock. The definition of shock is the reduction in blood flow by diminished cardiac output or maldistributed output such that potential irreversible tissue damage occurs. So definition of shock includes inadequate oxygen delivery to meet the metabolic demands, and it results in global tissue hypoperfusion and metabolic acidosis. Inadequate oxygen delivery to meet metabolic demands results in global tissue hypoperfusion and metabolic acidosis, and therefore shock can occur with a normal blood pressure, and hypotension can occur without shock. So hypotension is not the only criteria to define shock. Flow of blood means perfusion to the tissues. Adequate flow means adequate perfusion. Inadequate flow leads to inadequate or hypoperfusion, and hypoperfusion means shock. What is the physiology of perfusion? You must understand first. Physiology of perfusion will depend on three components of the circulatory system: the pump, that is the heart, the fluid, that is the blood, and the container is the circulatory tree. Causes of inadequate perfusion can be inadequate pump, that is because of inadequate preload, poor contractility, excessive afterload, or inadequate heart rate. Inadequate fluid volume can be hypovolemia, and inadequate container is excessive dilatation of the container and inadequate systemic vascular resistance. It is the arterioles, those are called resistance vessels, maintaining the resistance in the circulatory system and thus maintaining the blood flow. When this resistance is lost and the arterioles dilate, you can get a leaky type of situation and the container becomes inadequate and you can get shock. Now, what is blood pressure? Cardiac output is equal to stroke volume multiplied by heart rate. And blood pressure is cardiac output multiplied by the systemic vascular resistance. Changes in afterload and preload. Whenever there is peripheral vasoconstriction, there is increased peripheral vascular resistance, and therefore there is increased afterload, and that raises the blood pressure. Whenever increased peripheral vasodilatation, there is decreased peripheral vascular resistance, there is reduced afterload, and there is a drop in blood pressure. If there is an increase in fluid volume, there is increase in preload and increase in contractility due to Starling's law, and thus increase in cardiac output, which results in rise in blood pressure. A decrease in fluid volume, on the other hand, reduces the preload, reduces the contractility by the Starling's law, reduces the cardiac output, and thus reduces the blood pressure. Maintenance of fluid volume is by various mechanisms. Whenever there is a borderline deficit of fluid volume, the renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system works through the kidneys to regulate the balance of sodium and water. Whenever there is reduction in plasma volume or reduction in sodium, it is detected by the kidney's juxtaglomerular apparatus, which releases renin as a hormone, which converts angiotensin into angiotensin 1. And angiotensin 1 is then converted to angiotensin 2 via angiotensin converting enzyme. and this angiotensin 2 then causes peripheral vasoconstriction, increase in peripheral vascular resistance, increase in blood pressure. It also causes increase in sodium uptake, increase in fluid volume and increase in blood pressure. It also causes increase in diuretic hormone secretion, antidiuretic hormone secretion, which also increases fluid volume and blood pressure. It also stimulates the adrenal cortex, which releases aldosterone, which retains the sodium and thus increases the fluid volume and increases the blood pressure. The container is the, now vasculature is a continuous closed pressurized system. Microcirculation will depend on the local tissue needs and blood flow is dependent on the peripheral vascular resistance. Responses to shock can be: catecholamine release causes increased heart rate, heart contractility, venous and arterial tone, preload and thus trying to maintain the cardiac output. The neuroendocrine response will stimulate the hypothalamus, glucocorticoid, growth hormone and aldosterone mechanism, and renal will stimulate the antidiuretic hormone renin and angiotensin mechanism. The normal compensation for a early or compensated shock can be progressive vasoconstriction, increased blood flow only to the major organs, increased cardiac output or maintaining the cardiac output the bare minimum, increase the respiratory rate and volume but decrease in urine output to conserve the fluid. At the cellular level, because of what is the cellular response to shock? Because of tissue, reduced tissue perfusion, there is impaired cellular metabolism, and therefore there is, because of reduced tissue perfusion, there is reduced reduction in oxygen use, and therefore there is anaerobic metabolism, reduced ATP synthesis at the cellular level, and reduced sodium pump function, which increases the intracellular sodium and water, which causes cellular edema and reduction in vascular volume, which also impairs glucose usage, and all this will stimulate the clotting cascade and inflammatory response. Normally there is aerobic metabolism where you can see 6 molecules of oxygen and a molecule of glucose can give rise to 6 molecules of carbon dioxide, 6 molecules of water vapor, 36 molecules of ATP, and the heat generated is 417 kilocalories. While the anaerobic metabolism, there is lack of oxygen and therefore only glucose is used for metabolism, which the end product of metabolism can be 2 molecules of lactic acid, only two molecules of ATP, and the heat generated is only 32 kilocalories. And thus, patient has hypothermia, clotting cascade and metabolic acidosis. Because of inadequate cellular oxygenation, there is anaerobic metabolism, inadequate energy production, metabolic failure, cell death. Because of lactic acid production, there is metabolic acidosis that also causes cell death. And therefore, in a patient of uncompensated or irreversible shock, all the three things, that is metabolic acidosis, clotting cascade and hypothermia, set in, and this is called as trauma triad of death. And once irreversible shock occurs with all these three parameters set in, then the prognosis is extremely grave. The cellular response to shock, net result of cellular shock can be systemic lactic acidosis, decreased myocardial contractility, decreased vascular tone, decreased blood pressure, preload and cardiac output. The stages of shock can be compensated shock, when the renal mechanisms, the hormonal and neuroendocrine mechanisms and others can compensate for the shock and can maintain the blood pressure to an acceptable level. uncompensated shock when the defense mechanisms of the body have started to fail. And last is the irreversible shock when irreversible shock is when metabolic acidosis, hypothermia and clotting cascade set in, and then it is very difficult to save the patient. Compensation shock is when the defense mechanisms are successful in maintaining perfusion and the presentation is tachycardia, decreased skin perfusion, altered mental status. Uncompensated shock, defense mechanisms begin to fail, presentation is hypotension, prolonged capillary refill, marked increase in heart rate, rapid 3D pulse, agitation, restlessness and confusion. Irreversible shock, complete failure of compensatory mechanisms, death even in presence of resuscitation because of trauma triad of death has set in, and which leads to multiple organ dysfunction syndrome, that is MODS. The progression of physiologic effects as shock ensues. There is cardiac depression, respiratory distress, renal failure and DIC. Result is end organ failure. The various types of shock can be hypovolemic shock because of blood volume problem or fluid volume problem, a cardiogenic shock because of the blood pump problem, and vasogenic shock when the blood vessels are problematic. The types of shock can be otherwise labeled as hypovolemic, septic, cardiogenic, anaphylactic, neurogenic and obstructive. Hypovolemic shock can be like hemorrhagic and non-hemorrhagic. Cardiogenic is because of the primary pump failure. Obstructive is like cardiac tamponade, tension pneumothorax, massive pulmonary embolus and air embolism. Distributive shock or container problem is septic shock, anaphylactic shock and spinal cord injury or spinal shock. And endocrine shock can be due to hypo or hyperthyroidism and adrenal insufficiency. The signs and symptoms can be restlessness, anxiety, decreasing level of consciousness, dull eyes, rapid shallow respirations, nausea and vomiting, thirst, diminished urine output. Hypovolemia will cause weak, rapid pulse or very low volume 3D pulse, pale, cool, clammy skin. Cardiogenic shock may cause weak, rapid pulse or weak, slow pulse, and there will be pale, cool, clammy skin. In neurogenic shock, there will be weak, slow pulse and dry, flushed skin. And in sepsis and anaphylaxis, will cause weak, rapid pulse and dry, flushed skin. So, approach to a patient in shock, history, recent illness, fever, chest pain, shortness of breath, abdominal pain, comorbidities, any medications patient is on, toxins and injections he has taken, anything, recent hospitalization or surgery, and baseline mental status. On physical examination, you have to see for vital signs, CNS, mainly the mental status, skin, the color of the skin, the temperature of the skin, any rashes and sores. Cardiovascular, you have to see for jugular veins and heart sounds. Respiratory, lung sounds, respiratory rate, oxygen saturation and arterial blood gases. GI, abdominal pain, guarding, rigidity and rebound tenderness. And renal, mainly urine output. For an adequate perfusion, there must be at least 30 ml urine output per hour. So approach to the patient in shock, the ABCs can be cardiorespiratory monitorization, pulse oximetry, supplemental oxygen, IV access, arterial blood gases and labs, Foley's catheter, vital signs including rectal temperature. Physical examination, mental status, vital signs, skin color, temperature, pulses, etc. If there is any infectious source, search for it. And in the labs, you can do complete blood count, chemistries, that is kidney function tests and others, lactate, coagulation studies, cultures and arterial blood gases. Further evaluation can be CT of head or sinuses, lumbar puncture depending on if you are thinking of meningitis or something, wound cultures if there are wounds and sites of sepsis, acute abdominal series like FAST, focus abdominal sonography, abdominal pelvic CT or U ultrasound, cortisol level, fibrinogen, fibrinogen degradation products and D-dimer. Monitoring minimum is ECG, pulse oximetry, blood pressure and urine output. Ideally should be minimum 30 ml per hour for adequate management. Additional modalities can be central venous pressure, invasive blood pressure, cardiac output, base deficit and serum lactate. Hypovolemic shock can be because of non-hemorrhagic type, prolonged continuous vomiting or diarrhea and or diarrhea, bowel obstruction, pancreatitis, burns, neglect and environmental. Hemorrhagic shock can be due to GI bleed, traumatic bleed, massive hemoptysis, abdominal aortic aneurysm rupture, ectopic pregnancy, postpartum bleeding. How to quickly estimate the blood pressure? When you can feel the radial pulse, blood pressure is around 70 or 80. When you can only feel the carotid pulse, it can be 60. When you can feel the dorsalis pedis, probably the blood pressure is nearly 90 millimeters of mercury or more. That is a rough estimate. If you palpate a pulse, you know the systolic blood pressure is at least this number. Hypovolemic shock, lab studies we already discussed. Initial lab studies should include analysis of complete blood count, electrolyte levels, sodium, potassium, chloride, bicarbonates, urea, creatinine, glucose levels, prothrombin time, activated partial thromboplastin time, arterial blood gases and urine analysis in patient trauma. Blood should be typed and cross-matched for SOS transfusion. Hypovolemic shock, patients with marked hypotension and or unstable conditions must first be resuscitated adequately. This treatment takes precedence over imaging studies and may include immediate interventions and immediately taking the patient to the operating room. The workup for the patient with trauma and signs and symptoms of hypovolemia is directed toward finding the source of blood loss. If a traumatic abdominal injury is suspected of FAST, focus abdominal sonography for trauma, ultrasound can be performed in the stable or unstable patient. CT is typically performed only in the stable patient. If long bone fractures are suspected, X-ray should be obtained and the bone stabilized. Management of hypovolemic shock. The pre-hospital care treatment of patient with hypovolemic shock often begins at an accident site or at home. The pre-hospital care team should work to prevent further injury, transport the patient to the hospital as rapidly as possible and initiate appropriate treatment in the field. Prevention of further injury applies mostly to the patient with trauma. The cervical spine must be immobilized and the patient must be extricated if applicable and moved to a stretcher. Splinting of fractures can minimize further neurovascular injury and blood loss. Although in selected cases stabilization may be beneficial, rapid transport of sick patients to the hospital remains the most important aspect of pre-hospital care. Definitive care of the hypovolemic patient usually requires hospital and sometimes surgical intervention. Any delay in definitive care, examples such as delayed transport, is potentially harmful. Most hospital interventions involve immobilizing the patient if trauma is involved, securing an adequate airway, ensuring ventilation, and maximizing circulation. Some procedures such as starting IV lines or splinting of extremities can be performed while a patient is being extricated. Again, same thing we are seeing, evaluation of hypovolemic shock, CBC, arterial blood gases and lactate levels, electrolytes, kidney function tests, coagulation studies, and blood grouping and cross-matching. And as indicated, you may do chest X-ray, you must do pelvic X-ray, abdomen pelvis CT or sonography, chest CT, GI endoscopy, bronchoscopy, and vascular radiology. Monitoring for the patient in shock, we already seen this. The mainstay of treatment is maximize oxygen delivery, control further blood loss, and resuscitate with fluid. Airway, breathing, circulation, oxygen delivery, and achieve endpoints of resuscitation is the main goal of treatment. A, B, C, D, E. Controlling further blood loss, external bleeding should be controlled with direct pressure. Internal bleeding requires surgical intervention. Long bone fractures should be treated with traction to decrease blood loss. Fluid resuscitation must always be done by crystalloids mainly, or colloids can be given, but then it should be, after that it should be substituted with blood. Infusion rates, with an 18 gauge needle in the peripheral vein, you can give about 50 ml by gravity and 150 ml by pressure per minute. 16 gauge will give 100 and 225, 14 gauge will give 150 to 275 ml per minute, and 8.5 French center line catheter can give 200 to 450 ml per minute. Endpoints of resuscitation are: goal of resuscitation is to maximize survival and minimize morbidity. Use objective hemodynamic and physiologic values to guide therapy. Goal directed approach: urine output should be at least 30 ml per hour. CVP should be 8 to 12 millimeters of mercury. Mean arterial pressure should be 65 to 90 millimeters of mercury. And central venous oxygen concentration should be more than 80%. Persistent hypotension can be due to inadequate volume resuscitation, pneumothorax, cardiac tamponade, hidden bleeding, adrenal insufficiency, and medication allergy. The next type of shock is cardiogenic shock, mainly seen by our physician colleagues. Shock is characterized by primary myocardial dysfunction, resulting in the inability of the heart to maintain adequate cardiac output. Etiologies can be inflow problems, intrinsic pump problems, and outflow problems. In cardiogenic shock, there is reduction in cardiac output, therefore there is renin angiotensin system mechanism activation, which causes volume preload increasing, increased myocardial oxygen demand, and thus further reduces cardiac output. There is impaired myocardial function, which also further reduces myocardial oxygen demand and reduces cardiac output. It also increases the systemic vascular resistance and therefore reduces cardiac output because of the pump failing there. And there is increased dyspnea, and therefore which also reduces in reduction in oxygen supply and thus reduction in cardiac output. Cardiogenic shock inflow problems can be pericardial tamponade, tension pneumothorax, mitral and tricuspid valve stenosis, idiopathic hypertrophic subaortic stenosis with filling defects, pump problems like acute myocardial infarction, myocarditis, cardiomyopathy, myocardial contusion are all pump problems that can cause shock. Outflow problems can be like pulmonary embolism, aortic and pulmonary stenosis, mitral insufficiency, especially in the setting of acute myocardial infarction, secondary to papillary muscle rupture or dysfunction, and ventricular septal defect and air embolism. The clinical presentation will be abnormal heart sounds, murmurs of mitral stenosis, mitral insufficiency, aortic stenosis, pulmonary stenosis or VSD. There is a pathologic S4 atrial gallop, pathologic S3 ventricular gallop. These are the other heart sounds you can see. There will be ECG abnormalities, pericardial tamponade, low voltage and or electrical alternance, acute myocardial infarction, ST segment elevation, pathologic Q waves, new bundle branch blocks and other conduction abnormalities, that is nodal blocks and dysarrhythmias. So it is defined as systolic blood pressure less than 90, CI is less than 2.2 liters per meter per minute per meter square, and PCWP, that is pulmonary wedge pressure, less than 18 millimeters of mercury. Signs are cool, mottled skin, tachypnea, hypotension, altered mental status, narrowed pulse pressure, rahals and murmur. The pericardial tamponade, muffled heart tones, elevated neck veins. There can be in tension pneumothorax also, there can be jugular vein dilatation, tracheal deviation, decrease or absent unilateral breath sounds, and chest hyporesonance on affected side. The treatment of cardiogenic shock, the goals are airway stability and improving myocardial pump function, cardiac monitor, pulse oximetry, supplemental oxygen, IV access. Intubation will decrease preload and result in hypotension. Be prepared to give fluid bolus. In acute myocardial infarction, you can give aspirin, beta blockers, morphine, heparin. If no pulmonary edema, IV fluid challenge. If pulmonary edema is there, dopamine will increase heart rate and thus cardiac work. Dobutamine may drop blood pressure. Combination therapy may be more effective. And percutaneous interventions or thrombolytics are good to reverse the AMI. Right ventricular infarct, fluids and dobutamine. An acute mitral regurgitation or VSD, you can give pressors like dobutamine and nitroprusside. Management is treat reversible causes, optimize pump function, do whatever myocardial salvage you can do, and consider thrombolytics, angioplasty and balloon, aortic balloon counterpulsation in specific cases. Optimizing pump function, you can do by invasive monitoring if available, aggressive airway management, judicious fluid management, and pressure agents like dobutamine and dopamine. Cardiogenic shock management, we already seen this. The medical management can be morphine as needed for anxiolysis, cautious use of diuretics in congestive heart failure, vasodilators as needed for afterload reduction, and short-acting beta blocker esmolol for refractory tachycardia. Vasogenic shock, the etiologies can be septic shock, anaphylactic shock and neurogenic shock. Definition of septic shock is perfusion embarrassment secondary to dilated vascular bed in response to bacteria and their products circulating in the blood. Septicemia is a state of microbial invasion from a portal of entry into the bloodstream, which causes signs of illness. Sepsis is a systemic inflammatory response syndrome SIRS to documented infection. The manifestation of sepsis are the same as SIRS, and the clinical features include two or more of the following conditions. Temperature more than 38 degrees centigrade or less than 36, heart rate greater than 90, respiratory rate greater than 20 per minute or PaCO2 less than 32, and WBC count greater than 12,000 or less than 4,000 with immature forms. Severe sepsis, this is sepsis and SIRS associated with organ dysfunction, hypoperfusion or hypotension. Hypoperfusion and perfusion abnormalities may include but are not limited to lactic acidosis, oliguria, or an acute alteration in mental status. MODS or multiple organ dysfunction syndrome is the presence of altered organ function in a patient who is actually ill and in whom homeostasis cannot be maintained without intervention. Results from body's response to bacteria in bloodstream and vessels dilate and become leaky in septic shock. The pathophysiology is, it is mediator induced cellular injury, circulatory and metabolic response also. The gram positive and gram negative bacteria induce a variety of pro-inflammatory mediators, including cytokines, induced in host cells, macrophages, monocytes, and neutrophils by the bacterial cell wall component. Lipopolysaccharide gram-negative bacteria and lipeptidyldiclan gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria and lipoteichoic acid gram-positive bacteria. The predominant hemodynamic feature of septic shock is arterial vasodilation. Vasodilation will result in hypotension and shock. Factors responsible for myocardial depression or of sepsis are myocardial depressant substances, coronary blood flow abnormalities, pulmonary hypertension, various cytokines, nitric oxide, and beta receptor down regulation. These are the examples of various cell mediators that can cause septic shock: lipopolysaccharides, lipoteichoic acid, peptidoglycan, superantigens, and endotoxins. And these are hormonal mediators that can be there. Causes can be infection anywhere in the body, like lower respiratory infection, and the various organisms that can cause it. It can be urinary tract infection or soft tissue infections. GIT infections also can cause septic shock. And infection of the male and female reproductive system can also cause septic shock. Foreign bodies like implants in the knee joint and all with sepsis can cause septic shock. And risk factors for severe sepsis and septic shock are extremes of age less than 10 and more than 70, primary diseases like liver cirrhosis, alcoholism, diabetes mellitus, cardiovascular diseases, solid malignancies, and hematological malignancies can predispose to septic shock. There can be people who are immunosuppressed and can be more prone to septic shock, like neutropenia, immunosuppressive therapy patient is on, corticosteroid therapy, IV drug abuse, complement deficiencies, asplenia, or patient has had major surgery, trauma, or burns. Invasive procedures like catheters, IV devices, prosthetic devices, hemodialysis, peritoneal dialysis catheters, endotracheal tubes, and prior antibiotic treatment, prolonged hospitalization, childbirth, abortion,
and other factors also like malnutrition can predispose one person to septicemia and septic shock. So infection is of a minor type, then it can increase causing bacteremia and sepsis, which can further increase to SIRS, that is systemic inflammatory response syndrome. And that is the pathogenesis of sepsis, causing septic shock due to systemic vasodilatation and then SIRS. The lab studies, CBC count with differential count, serum electrolytes and blood glucose, renal and hepatic function and arterial blood gases, prothrombin time and APTT, partial thromboplastin time, blood cultures, urine cultures and urine analysis, secretions or tissue from for gram stain and culture from the sites of potential infection. Imaging studies can be chest X-ray, abdominal X-rays, abdominal ultrasound, CT scans, LP if meningitis is suspected. If a patient is thought to have meningitis or encephalitis, perform an LP urgently. In patients with an acute fulminant presentation, a rapid onset of septic shock and a severe impairment of mental status, use this procedure to rule out bacterial meningitis. Treatment of septic shock, 2 large bore IV needles, normal saline IV fluid bolus, 1 to 2 liters, supplemental oxygen, empiric antibiotics based on suspected source as soon as possible. Antibiotics survival correlates with how quickly the correct drug was given. Cover gram positive and gram negative bacteria with various antibiotics like ceftriaxone and imipenem, etc. Add additional coverage as indicated. Pseudomonas, you can give gentamicin, cefepime. MRSA, you can give vancomycin. You can give clindamycin or metronidazole. And you can also give injection Tazar like drugs. Management, cardiac monitoring, non-invasive blood pressure monitoring and pulse oximetry are necessary because these patients often require intensive care admission for invasive monitoring and support. Supplemental oxygen is provided during initial stabilization and resuscitation. Resuscitate the patient from septic shock using supportive measures to correct hypoxia, hypotension and impaired tissue oxygenation. Identify the source of infection and treat with antimicrobial therapy, surgery or both. And maintain adequate oxygen system, organ system function guided by cardiovascular monitoring and interrupt the pathogenesis of multiple organ dysfunction syndrome. There is a treatment algorithm for septic shock, mainly to identify the source, give antibiotics in a proper and dose and immediately, and monitoring the patient and nursing care. Neurogenic shock occurs after acute spinal cord injury because the sympathetic outflow is disrupted, leaving unopposed vagal tone, results in hypotension and bradycardia. Spinal shock is temporary loss of spinal reflex activity below a total or near total spinal cord injury. Not the same as neurogenic shock, the terms are not interchangeable. Loss of sympathetic tone results in warm and dry skin, and shock usually lasts for 1 to 3 weeks. Any injury above T1 can disrupt the entire sympathetic system. Higher the injuries, worse the paralysis. So the definition of neurogenic shock, hypotension is the result of the loss of sympathetic vascular tone below the level of spinal cord injury. May also lose sympathetic tone to heart, usually a transient 3 to 7 day phenomenon. Clinical presentation, moderate hypotension, relative bradycardia, warm dry skin, flaccid paralysis below the level of spinal cord injury. And management, shock in the trauma patient is always hypovolemia, hemorrhagic shock until proven otherwise, and then only neurogenic shock is a diagnosis of exclusion. Neurogenic shock is a diagnosis of exclusion. Management of neurogenic shock: alpha agonist to augment tone if perfusion still inadequate, dopamine at alpha doses, that is more than 10 microgram per kilogram per minute, ephedrine 12.5 to 25 milligram IV every 3 to 4 hours, treat bradycardia with atropine to maximum 3 milligram, may need transcutaneous or transvenous pacing temporarily. Anaphylactic shock: anaphylaxis is a severe systemic hypersensitivity reaction characterized by multi-system involvement, which is IgE mediated usually. The anaphylactoid reaction is clinically indistinguishable from anaphylaxis, do not require a sensitizing exposure, it is not IgE mediated. Anaphylactic shock can result from severe allergic reaction, body response to allergens by releasing histamine, and histamine causes vessels to dilate and become leaky, loss of consciousness, there are rashes, swelling of tongue, inability to swallow, angioneurotic edema, and rapid swelling of the throat tissues. The allergic reactions can be caused by skin contacts like poisons, plants, animal scratches, pollens, latex. There can be bee sting, there can be medication, nuts and shellfish, or there can be because of inhalation by pollen, dust, mold and mildew, and animal dander. What are some of the symptoms of anaphylaxis? First is pruritus, flushing, urticaria can appear. Next is throat fullness, anxiety, chest tightness, shortness of breath, and lightheadedness. Finally, altered mental status, respiratory distress, and circulatory collapse. Risk factors for fetal anaphylaxis: poorly controlled asthma and previous anaphylaxis. Reoccurrence rates are 40-60% for insect stings, 20-40% for radio contrast agents, 10-20% for penicillin, and most common causes are antibiotics, insects, and food. It induces mild localized urticaria, can progress into full anaphylaxis. Symptoms usually begin within 16 minutes of exposure. Faster the onset of symptoms, more severe reaction. Biphasic phenomena occurs in up to 20% of patients. Symptoms return 3 to 4 hours after initial reaction has cleared. A lump in my throat and hoarseness heralds life-threatening laryngeal edema. Patients with anaphylaxis will have hypotension, develop urticaria, itch, develop wheezing and difficulty in breathing, that is because of bronchospasm and angioedema. Clinical diagnosis defined by airway compromise, hypotension or involvement of cutaneous, respiratory or GI systems. Look for exposure to drug, food or insect. Labs have hardly any role. The treatment is ABC, and then angioedema and respiratory compromise may require immediate intubation. IV fluid is cardiac monitor, pulse oximetry, oxygenation, epinephrine or adrenaline. Second line is corticosteroids and H1 or H2 blockers. Epinephrine 0.3 milligram intramuscular of 1 in 1000. Repeat every 5 to 10 minutes as needed. Caution with patients taking beta blockers can cause severe hypertension due to unopposed alpha stimulation. For cardiovascular collapse, 1 milligram IV of 1 in 10,000. If refractory, start IV drip. Steroids: methylprednisolone 125 milligram IV, prednisolone 60 milligram per oral. Antihistamines: H1 diphenhydramine 25 to 50 milligram IV, and H2 blockers ranitidine 50 milligram IV. Bronchodilators: albuterol nebulizer, atropine, magnesium sulfate 2 gram IV over 20 minutes, and glucagon for patients taking beta blockers and with refractory hypotension.
1 milligram IV every 5 minutes until hypotension resolves. Anaphylactic shock deposition. All patients who receive epinephrine should be observed for 4 to 6 hours. If symptoms free, discharge home. If on beta blockers or if you have severe reaction in past, consider admission. Obstructive shock, tension pneumothorax, air trapped in pleural space with one-way valve, air pressure builds up, mediastinal shift, impending venous return, chest pain, shortness of breath, decreased breath sounds, no test needed, treatment is immediate needle decompression and then chest tube if necessary. Cardiac tamponade, blood in pericardial sac prevents venous return to heart and contraction of heart. Related to trauma, pericarditis, myocardial infarction, Beck's triad, hypotension, muffled heart sounds and JVD. Diagnosis is large heart, chest X-ray, echo and treatment is pericardiocentesis. Pulmonary embolism, Virchow's triad, hypercoagulable, venous injury, venous status. Signs can be tachypnea, tachycardia, hypoxia. Low risk D-dimer is positive, high risk is CT chest or VQ scan may be done and treatment is heparin and consider thrombolytics. Aortic stenosis, resistance to systolic ejection causes decreased cardiac function, chest pain with syncope, systolic ejection murmur, diagnosed with echo, vasodilators will drop blood pressure, treatment is valve surgery. Thank you.